Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to Worship at Bethlehem. We are so glad you've joined us for virtual worship this week. I have a few announcements as part of community time that I'd like to share with you. First of all, the pumpkins are here, and that is really exciting. That's a little bit of normalcy in the midst of a very abnormal season for people in our community. This year is especially exciting because the proceeds from the pumpkin patch, rather than going to the Youth Mission Fund, will be redirected to the United Way COVID-19 Crisis Response Fund of the Greater Evansville Region. That will keep the dollars local and will help organizations that have been struggling because of the pandemic. This week, you should have received your pledge card in the mail. We invite you to return that to the church, either by mailing it back or putting it in the mailbox that's in the vestibule by the church office. We'd love to have those back before October 18th, which will be Consecration Sunday. And finally, you got an email this week as well about providing chili or lasagna for the United Caring Services. So please look over that. That would also be in the worship email, and see if you can help provide a meal for our friends experiencing hunger during this cold, as the weather gets colder. Please join me now for our call to worship. The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims his handiwork.
The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple.
The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear, enlightening the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb.
Thank you.
Please join me in today's scripture reading from the book of Exodus, chapter 20, verses 1 through 17. Then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents, to the third and the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work. You, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox, or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. May God help us to learn from this reading.
Well, here we are, smack dab in the middle of an election cycle. There are yard signs multiplying in our neighborhoods, ads on television, and many of us suffered through the debate this week. We live in a country where we get to have a say in how we organize life together at every level. We will soon be voting for president and governor, of course, but also for attorneys general, senators, representatives, council members, judges, school board members, even the coroner. This is one of the things that we most cherish about America. We have a say in how we're governed. And so, theoretically, if what has been happening hasn't been working for us, we can have a fresh start every few years and try something new. But along with the right to have input in our leadership comes the great weight of that responsibility. We are responsible for the people we put in office, and when there are injustices, we share some of that responsibility too. Unfortunately, we don't have the option to simply have God be the one in charge of our country. That was something reserved only for Israel and only for a time. Still, as we are poised to go to the ballot box, we would do well to review the way the Ten Commandments reveal how God wanted God's people to organize. Rather than simply a list of rules, Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann challenges us to consider the Ten Commandments as policy statements. And I want us to use that shift as a guiding principle as we touch on each of these commandments today. If we consider them as policy statements revealing truths about God's values, how might they help inform the circumstances of our day and help us make the many decisions we will soon have before us on Election Day? If you worshiped with us throughout the summer, you'll recall that we followed Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob's family into Egypt. And you'll remember how they were enslaved and how God heard their cries and how God came down and sent Moses and the 10 plagues and the Red Sea. And after they left Egypt, you'll remember that they found themselves in the wilderness confronting new challenges like fresh water and food shortages. And they had to get used to life under new leadership. Whereas their previous life had been marked by scarcity, their new life was marked by sufficiency. God was faithful to them, providing safe water, manna, and quail. The dust was settling on a time of incredible upheaval for the Israelites. And in our passage for today, God meets Moses on a mountain to share with him and with the Israelites who are overhearing this conversation at the base of the mountain, God's expectations moving forward. God rescued them from Egypt, but this relationship will not continue only one-sided. God will continue to give, yes, but now they also have responsibilities of their own. Here, there is no going to the ballot box to elect the legislature. God is the lawmaker, and in God's opening words, God lays out why God is the boss. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. In the Jewish tradition, this first commandment is actually just, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. Their tradition pushes, you shall have no other gods before me, to the second commandment. When understood this way, the declaration of God's rescue is itself a command. Like a parent who punctuates the final word of negotiations with, because I'm the mother, or the teacher who says, it's my classroom, God lays out that God is the ultimate authority. Except God is not punctuating. God is informing them right off the top. Like saying, before we even get started, I have two words for you. The Exodus. Mic drop. God keeps the rescue from Egypt at the forefront because if their memory lags on where they have been, on what God has done for them and brought them through, God knows that they will wander into trouble, which we know that they do, and we know that we do. Keeping that Exodus event in the forefront of our minds, let us now turn to address each of the Ten Commandments.
Commandment 1, you shall have no other gods before me.
We know that the land of Egypt, as well as other neighboring peoples, were polytheists. Under certain circumstances, you would appeal to one god, and under other circumstances, you might appeal to another. But here, Yahweh is calling them to appeal only to God, to come only to this one true God. Yahweh is calling them to a life of coherence. God is telling the people that in all spheres, he is ultimate. Now, we are likely not tempted by other deities here in the 21st century, but can we relate to turning to other options when we have needs or when we are upset or when we are stressed, depending on what our circumstances are? How might God also be calling us to a life of coherence where we turn only to God?
Commandment 2, you shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth.
While we often think about this commandment as a warning against idols that compete with Yahweh, it really was probably meant to be a warning against trying to make an idol for or of Yahweh. God is not constrained by the limitations of something our hands could make. God is separate and undomesticated. Again, I doubt any of us are tempted to make idols to use for worshiping God, but I think we can think about whether or not we are ever tempted to limit God to maybe four walls and stained glass. Do we behave in ways that attempt to diminish God's freedom, to tell God what God can and cannot do? Do we ever try to box God in?
Commandment 3, you shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God.
This commandment is the reason that my mother taught us that we could only say, oh my gosh. But is taking God's name in vain really only about using it in moments of surprise or anger? The NRSV renders this commandment as make wrongful use of the name of the Lord. Are there other ways that we can misuse God's name? When we claim to speak for God while not showing love to our neighbor, do we misuse God's name? When we claim to know with certainty the will of God, do we misuse God's name? Whenever we use God's name as a means to an end, do we misuse God's name? Do you see other ways that people misuse God's name in our day and age?
Commandment 4. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy.
This is a commandment where somewhere along the way we kind of decided it was kind of optional. Culturally, we have relegated this commandment to being a nice offer of a day off that we can either take God up on or refuse. And usually, we refuse. I am as guilty as anyone of treating all 7 days as opportunities for productivity. Resting on the Sabbath is not just about making sure we all relax and live a little. It's not even actually meant to be an opportunity for entertainment, as we sometimes misunderstand. The Sabbath day is meant to be a replay of that first Sabbath day when God himself rested from creating. Moreover, it is meant to send a message to the forces that would have us believe that we were made for nothing more than to be cogs in a machine. There is no bottom to the well of the idol of productivity. It will take and take and take until we have nothing left to give. Have you ever been pushed to the point where you feel like you have nothing left to give? I think many of us may actually be feeling that way right now. That is what the Sabbath is meant to protect us from. It is meant to remind us of our humanity, of our limitations as created beings. And it's supposed to remind us also of who our true God is. The Sabbath is, in fact, a political statement and a resounding refutation of Pharaoh's politics that would work us to death. So, how can we be better about this? How can we quit treating this commandment as if it were optional?
Commandment 5, honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you.
The Israelites' days being long in the land depends on the honoring of their parents. That sounds like great news for parents. But the word here translated honor can also be translated as be heavy, or we might say give weight to. So in that way, we could think of the commandment as give weight to your father and your mother. How might that change our understanding? The theme of remembering is prominent throughout the book of Exodus. God remembers, and the people are urged repeatedly to also remember. Here, the theme of remembering comes through in the commandment. The key to success is for future generations to take steps forward, yes, but also to be mindful and rooted in their history. How can the church balance that tension of moving forward while giving weight to the wisdom of those who have gone before us?
Commandment 6, you shall not murder.
The word in this commandment can be translated either murder or kill, and raises all kinds of questions for us about good guys versus bad guys, justifiable versus unjustifiable killing, and who gets to decide what is and isn't justified. The death penalty, war, abortion, and probably many other hot button conversations. We will remember that Jesus famously expanded this commandment to include even anger in the Sermon on the Mount. Most of us are not likely to be seriously tempted to take another's life, at least I hope not. But do we ever grow indifferent to systems and policies that lead to death? And how far does our responsibility reach for the unnecessary deaths in our world, even if they aren't directly at our own hands? What would it look like for the church to promote life and policies that are life-giving for everyone at every turn?
Commandment 7, you shall not commit adultery.
Here is another commandment that Jesus expanded on, teaching that even a lustful gaze violates this commandment. And we would want to expand on it more fully as well, as in its original context, it exclusively pertained to a husband's right to his wife as essentially his property. Only a woman could commit adultery against her husband. A husband could not commit adultery against his wife. If a couple were to engage in an extramarital affair, the crime would have been committed against the husband only. When we think about this commandment in our own time, we might think about fidelity in our relationships. Are there temptations beyond physical infidelity that threaten to undermine our commitments? What does a healthy relationship look like when it is truly life-giving for both parties?
Commandment 8, you shall not steal.
This one seems pretty straightforward. We should not take what doesn't belong to us. But how might we think about this differently in a world with so much inequality? Is breaking and entering the only kind of theft that there is? Or are there systems of theft that lead to unjust compensation for work done? We live in a world where 820 million people go hungry. We live in a community where low-wage workers can't find safe and affordable housing for their families. And what about the environment? When our decisions today degrade the quality of life for future generations, is that a violation of you shall not steal?
Commandment 9. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor.
Honestly, I don't even know how to talk about this commandment in light of our current political climate. Except to say that as people of faith, we must be people who continue to pursue and value the truth. Perhaps most especially when that truth is inconvenient to the way that we want to see the world. We must resist the temptation to do what the rest of the world seems to do right now and define truth by what we want to be true. How can we continue to be truth seekers and truth promoters in the midst of so much untruth?
Commandment 10, you shall not covet.
And we circle back around to the theme of contentment and provision. God tells them they are not to live their lives wanting what their neighbors have. Generations down the line, the Israelites demand a king to be like their neighbors, and that leads them into all kinds of trouble. This is their warning, and ours, that life with God at the helm inspires but also requires contentment with what God has given us. When we pursue a proper relationship with God, we don't have the energy to want for more, to want for other things. We can trust in God's provision. Unfortunately, God will not be on the ballot next month. And there will be no perfect candidates to choose from any of the offices either. Even as we pray over these decisions and seek God's guidance, we will all be making compromises and concessions in our decision making. But God has shown us how God wants us to do life together. The Ten Commandments tell part of that story. How do we translate what we know about how God wants life to be into what we should do in the voting booth? It's not easy, simple, or straightforward, and we know that we will not all agree on how to do that. But when the dust settles, what we have chosen as a city, as a county, as a state, and as a nation will be our responsibility to own. Together, we create this government, these laws, this environment. If we don't like what our options are, if we don't like the way the discourse goes, then maybe reviewing these commandments today as policy statements can help us be part of the change that we hope to see. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Amen. Please pray with me. Dear God, guide us, our community, our state, and our nation as we prepare to vote over the next month or so. Our political climate is so volatile right now, and it wears on us. We don't even know what to pray for. But we ask that you might lead and guide us. Heal the brokenness of systems and relationships. Inspire us to work together for the good of all people. Lord, help us as your church to embody your values and set an example for the world around us. Help us to be faithful. And now we unite our hearts and voices to pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Today, we celebrate World Communion Sunday, and it's a special day, one that I cherish, because it's one of the few times when churches all around this world are focusing on the same thing, are in agreement. We have churches up and down Oak Hill Road that are sharing in communion today. We have churches all across the city, all across our country, all across our world, who today are gathering around the table, many of them virtually, to share the body and blood of Christ and remember the love that Jesus had for all of us. And that is a message that we all can enjoy today, a little bit of unity in the midst of some difficult circumstances in our country. And so I invite you to join me with whatever elements you have at home as we focus our hearts and our minds on the Lord's Supper, communion, the Last Supper, the Eucharist, many names for this one special meal. On the night when our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he gathered in the upper room with his disciples for a meal. And there he took the bread, gave thanks, broke it, and shared it with them, saying, "This is my body given for you." And likewise, after dinner, he took the cup, he blessed it, and shared it with them, saying, "This is my blood of a new covenant poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." I invite you to eat the bread and drink the cup. Scripture tells us when we share this meal, we proclaim Christ's death until he comes again. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. Dear God, we pray for the churches all around this globe who share in this meal today. We pray for their health and their safety. We pray for their ministry and their mission. And we give thanks for the ways that they are part of the one body of Christ. May we remember our role in the body. May this meal remind us of our unity. And may we be nourished both in body and spirit by these elements that we have shared. We pray these things in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.